peaceful eyes. Cellophane flowers of yellow and green towering over our head.
Okay, you have mic on? Okay, good. Okay. Are we ready? Let's get started then. I'm extremely delighted to introduce Catherine and Russell Gaynor, who are from the Center for Guided Imagery here in town. And I'm sure they'll tell you about that and what that is. And they're unique. And I think that you're going to enjoy this presentation very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
What a great introduction to be classified as unique. That's lovely. Thank you.
I thought you said great. I'm hearing things this morning. Oh, that comes after. Okay.
Okay.
Well, good morning.
Go on.
My name is Russell Gaynor, and I am a clinical social worker. And about 5 years ago, I was working in hospice and realized that I needed some extra tools to help with pain and symptom management for our clients. And I was intrigued by the idea of using hypnosis as that medium, and went to a local academy, got some training in hypnosis, and started using it actively. And then I ended up having a class where I met Catherine, and I was hypnotized ever since.
Oh. And he does the laundry too. Well, hello, I'm Catherine Gaynor, and I got into hypnosis in kind of a roundabout way. I was studying to be a minister and had a group at my house, and we had a retired Presbyterian minister who had studied hypnosis at the Jungian Institute. And at that time, I realized it was a marvelous tool for working through issues of grief, issues with forgiveness, and I had to go forward, I had to explore it, and that's how I got into it. And I've been a practicing professional hypnotist now for about 8 years here between Austin and San Antonio.
And Catherine and I, after we got married, decided that we wanted to open a private practice, and so we do counseling, consulting, and
hypnosis, guided imagery,
and education. We do a lot of classes like this as well, and then we teach hypnosis and guided imagery classes as well. And I guess someone had seen one of the presentations I did somewhere, and then they asked that I come and share some of what we do with you all. So for the next hour, we're going to be talking about some of the basics of what guided imagery is, how it can be used, and what it looks like. The purpose for the presentation is to provide you a basic understanding of guided visualization and imagery, along with some therapeutic value and methods of practice.
So some of the things we're going to look at, we're basically going to define guided imagery. We're going to look at the biological foundations. How does it affect the mind and the body? We're going to identify some of the historical and cultural contexts for use. We're going to look at the different types of imagery work, and then we're going to develop some ways of using it here in the classroom, okay?
As we go forward, one of the first things we like to do is start off with what a definition of guided imagery is. It's the process of leading or directing someone to intentionally form images for meaningful purposes. It provides an affective experience using many senses. Imagery is the imagination relating to an experience, feeling it, knowing it, all through the process of imagining it.
Now one can see why imagery is not just a visual tool. Because it is using all of your senses, it is a very comprehensive tool and it has a comprehensive effect on the body. So, how many of you think you use guided imagery? There's one. Well, the reality is all of you use it. You use it every day and you may not even realize it. And when we go forward in this, you'll understand what we're talking about.
If we start off looking at the biological foundation, one of the things that I've discovered in doing research about how the mind functions in thought processes, especially as it is developing, is it doesn't think in words, it doesn't really think in symbols, it thinks in images. We have an image of what our mother looks like, and then we have associated feelings and expressive experiences with that person, and those form the understanding of what our mother is. The essence of how we function as human beings is we use imagery as the foundational language for our minds.
So in essence, our brain, our bilobed brain, has two very different functions. The left side, as you know, was developed primarily for language skills, for our use with speech and developing the language. And then the right side is comprehensive for images and other information. So in essence, we're equipped with two distinct brains, and what connects the two is the corpus callosum, the bridge of neuronal fibers that connects the two. And you'll find in some artists like Yo-Yo Ma, if you study his brain, the corpus callosum is very large.
And the reason for that is he's actively using both sides of the brain, and we'll talk about the different hemispheres and what they do. So much integration between those two sides that the bridge between them, the pipeline that allows the transfer of information, has to be so much physically larger. So you actually see structural differences because of people who use guided or imagery actively in their artistic talents or thought processes.
Okay, this is just a basic slide giving you the different functions of both the left and right side of the brain. The left brain is adapted for linear thinking, so judging time, math, rhythm, coordination of complex movements, speech, writing, and drawing. Whereas the right brain focuses on the perceptual skills, recognizing patterns, emotions, faces, melodies. Imagery is the means by which our brain categorizes and assimilates information in a comprehensive form. One of the examples I like to use is in high school, if you took algebra or geometry and you got all these really complex formulas and you kind of looked at them and went, huh? Well, once the teacher explained the purpose of those formulas, this makes more sense. It's also easier to retain. So once again, the right brain synthesizes the linear information that the left brain can assimilate, and it creates a comprehensive image that one can relate to.
Well, let's take a look at how this affects the body. Imagery is the biological connection between the mind and the body, directly connecting and activating the autonomic nervous system. It's interesting in the ways that we see imagery commonly used. Most of us use it in the negative form. How many of us have had a situation that hasn't been pleasant? Maybe it's an encounter with a boss or a significant other and you've gotten in a fight. And then later you kind of replay that over and over again. What's your body do as you're thinking about that? Stressed out, mm-hmm. Yeah. You find that you start getting tense, the anxiety level, you get short of breath. You'll find, if we put you on monitors, we'd find an increased heart rate, increased blood pressure. It's the autonomic nervous system responding to what we're thinking.
So why don't we just try a little exercise, if you will. Take just a moment, and you're welcome to get comfortable in your seat and close your eyes. This is very brief. And I'd like you to imagine you've just gone to the grocery store and you've picked out a big, fat, juicy lemon. And you've taken it home now, and you could make yourself some iced tea, perhaps. And perhaps you roll that lemon on the cutting board and bring it up to your nose and just take a sniff. You can smell the rind. Now I'd like you to imagine pulling out a knife and cutting that lemon in half and cutting a wedge off and watching the juices flow out of that lemon. Bring it up to your nose and breathe in that wonderful, tart, sweet, sour, citrusy smell. Okay, open your eyes. Okay, did we have anyone puckering in here? Anyone salivating? Is there a lemon in this room? It's fun from this perspective. Stand over here and watch the people going.
No. And what's interesting about that activity is all we did was simply ask your mind to bring those images forth, and your body automatically responded to it as if it were real. Think of the power that that holds, because whatever you think, your body is going to respond to it as if it were so.
So biologically, since we skipped this part, the messages are sent from the higher centers of the brain, the imagery, down to the autonomic centers, and your body responds as if it were real. So once again, saying that this is intensely powerful, what you think is what you experience, to make it that straightforward, that generic.
And whether or not these images are real, the lower part of the brain apparently responds accordingly, as long as there's no contradictory information. Now let me give you an idea of what that looks like. Sitting there, looking at me, pretend that you're on a roller coaster. And can you see yourself going up higher?
They're not. Okay, for these few, there's a few people in here going, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Now what I want you to do next is I want you to close your eyes. Don't want to do that. Okay.
That's
don't like roller coasters. How about an elevator? An elevator, okay? All right, we'll do the elevator then. All right, close your eyes and imagine yourself on a very fast elevator. And you get in, and you feel the doors close, and you push a button going up. And can you feel the sensation as the elevator begins lifting you and rising faster?
I'm watching the lights light up on the buttons.
Good.
Okay.
Now, what was the difference between sitting there with your eyes open and then sitting there with your eyes closed? It's more real with your eyes closed, isn't it? Because the visual input that your body is receiving, sitting in this room, contradicts the suggestions that we're giving. That's why guided imagery is much more effective when you have somebody who is able to close their eyes and eliminate as much sensory input from the senses as possible.
So it's precisely this body-based focus that makes guided imagery such a powerful tool that we can all use. And it's interesting to think that an average person has over 10,000 thoughts that are going through their mind on an average day. And many of these thoughts are negative, self-deprecating thoughts. Approaching a class going, gosh, how am I going to make it through this class? All these different thoughts that we have, and that has a very real impact on our body and how we do, how we function. So it makes it just that much more important to recognize that how you think and what you think has an effect on how you feel and how you perform.
Some of the interesting things that Catherine and I have discovered as we've started working on teaching this are that a lot of the earlier civilizations and religious references supported the use of guided imagery as well. If you think about the verbal or oral histories that were used, simply what those were stories that inspired the imagination to create images of the epic battles, of the situations that they were recording for the historical purposes.
Yeah. So many of the ancient traditions, Navajo Indians, certainly the ancient Greeks and Egyptians, used imagery as a part of their healing practices. Matter of fact, they truly believed that you had to clear the mind of superfluous information before you could even tackle the issues of the body.
Aristotle and Hippocrates also believed that images release the spirits inside the brain that arouse the heart and other parts of the body. They also thought that the idea of thinking about a disease was enough to bring on its symptoms.
Now, interestingly enough, in the Western approach, up to about 1650, guided imagery was an essential part of our healing traditions as well, here in America and in England. It wasn't until natural sciences took over the medical practices that we've really come to disassociate the mind from the body healing. And then we come up to the turn of the century where we have Freud taking over psychology in Europe, and that also affected us here in America. And guided imagery just kind of went underground, but there were a few important clinicians that used it very actively, one of which, the most popular, of course, is Jung, used it very actively. How do you think it's used today? Okay, other than medically, how do you think guided imagery is used today, most commonly?
Advertising.
Our society is swamped with the use of imagery. And isn't it interesting that you don't have to say very much? All you have to do is show a picture of someone driving a really cool car up a cliff. That's all that's presented. but your mind goes off with their, oh, wow, wouldn't that feel great? What, you know, I would look really cool doing that, and that would make me an adventurous spirit, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da. That's what imagery does. We don't necessarily assess its relevance. We just assimilate it. And that makes it a powerful, powerful tool in our lives.
Just the simple exposure to hours and hours of television. One of the things that Catherine and I try to do with the kids is try to help them recognize some of the ways that the imagery is used. So when we see a detergent commercial, we stop and say, kids, do you really think that we're going to be able to have five more hours in our day if we use that detergent? And yet that's the image, that's the association that the advertiser is trying to link with that product.
Mm-hmm. Now, also in our contemporary practices, guided imagery has been used. Starting in the 1970s, we saw a few practitioners, Carl and Stephanie Simonton, Irving Oyle, Asangioli, I can never say his name correctly, started using guided imagery and studying it very actively with illnesses, specifically cancer and mental illnesses. And that was really the first time it was brought back into active practice here, and has since been used more and more regularly.
So all this goes to show that guided imagery or hypnosis is not considered new age. This is nothing that is new to our culture. It's simply a reinsurgence or reintroduction of some very old practices.
And a valuable tool.
Let's look at some of the ways that guided imagery can be used. One of the first things that we're very careful to point out to clients as we begin working is we don't intend the use of guided imagery to take the place of medical or psychological treatment. This is simply an adjunct to help move that process along a little faster.
Now, if you're doing self-help, motivational work at home, that's a different matter altogether. Of course, you can do that on your own, but it is not to take the place of medical or psychological care. But it certainly can enhance the performance and quality of life issues.
And we found it very beneficial for pain management, depression. I do a lot of grief and loss work with use of guided imagery, looking at self-esteem enhancing, motivation, etc.
So these are some of the basic types of healing imagery or imagery work. Now, you'll find many clinicians use many, many different names, but the reality is they boil down to these five. Relaxation imagery. That's pretty self-evident. What you're doing is you're just taking a moment to relax the mind, relax the body, clear out all the superfluous thoughts, and just take a breather. And sometimes that's so essential.
Did you have a question?
Absolutely.
And how successful were you with that?
Oh, there's...
Yeah.
They loved it.
Yeah.
Sometimes they come in and I wouldn't even get to ask them where they wanted to go. They tell me what they wanted to
go. Pretty soon wonderful. They come in, even if they don't need a treatment, huh? Just take me to the forest again.
Okay.
So we call those the...
Well, I'm wondering, what do
you
call them?
Yeah, what do we call them? The trance junkies is what we call them, yes.
Excellent lead into the next one, healing imagery. That is one of the areas that we use guided imagery in the healing modality. In cancer therapy, what we do is we have the client imagine healthy white cells going through, and sometimes they imagine them like polar bears going through and eating up the cancer cells, and that could be fish or something else. Everybody has their own preference of imagery. It really is very individual, but all you have to do is use a very gentle suggestion. Healing imagery is also used to boost the immune system. And for people who want to take a look at certain issues going on in the body. That's another valuable tool, is to go explore what's going on with the body.
I think we also extend in our practice the concept of healing imagery to the issues of emotional trauma and especially forgiveness. We find that there are a lot of people who harbor resentments or issues from their past that they have difficulty getting beyond. Mm-hmm. So using guided imagery for healing those emotional wounds can be very valuable as well.
Excellent. Pain and symptom management, that's pretty straightforward as well. You can use guided imagery to put your pain in a box, put it in the closet for just a while, just so you can get through. Or you can use imagery like a knob, turning off and on a light switch, or turning that pain down. Now, pain has a very important function in the body. It's there to alert you if something is wrong. But for clients, especially with long-term health issues or pain management issues, they can turn down that knob and give themselves a moment of peace.
When I was working in hospice, I did a lot of work actively with clients who had COPD or some of the other cancers, in doing pain and symptom management, and found that they were very responsive to, especially the COPD issue, when you had the clients who would get in this downward spiral where they would have this shortness of breath, which brought on panic, and the panic inspired more shortness of breath, and it just continued to exacerbate itself. So being able to do some relaxation, some guided imagery to help do some deep breathing and slower breathing was very useful for them at the as an adjunct to helping them augment what the medications were doing.
Mm-hmm. Rehearsal imagery, that's the one we do most often, and certainly it's something we all, since there's mainly women in here, we do that before we go to work or before we have that interview. What are we going to wear? What are we going to look like? How are we going to respond before you have that date? If you have your family coming over for dinner, you're using that imagery. Okay, what am I going to fix? And you're going through all the different things in your head of what can be done and how it can be done and what it will look like.
Or before that important business meeting or that date, you examine what you want it to feel like or what you expect is going to occur in that interaction. And usually what you believe is going to happen does oftentimes. And so when we go back to looking at how that affects our bodies, you can see why we end up getting more tense sometimes just in the anticipation of an encounter.
Spiritual imagery.
Oh, wait a minute. Rehearsal imagery. That's also where we're looking at the sports enhancement.
Absolutely.
A lot of the famous athletes will use rehearsal imagery as a way of picturing that perfect golf swing, picturing that beautiful hit off the tee, picturing firm, strong swimming strokes as they're, and watching their rhythm as their bodies are moving through that activity. So those are the ways professionals use guided imagery as far as rehearsing them through for enhancement of their performance.
That would also apply to academic enhancement, sexual enhancement, motivation, all of those would go under the rehearsal imagery. Now, spiritual imagery is actually one of my favorites. And just loosely put, that's helping an individual redefine their connection to their God, the universe, how they are connected with themselves. What is their value? And it's a marvelous tool to use in association with psychological treatment. If someone's seeing a counselor, and to use this therapy alongside it, is works hand in hand. It's a beautiful fit. Simply because many of the questions we have, say if you're suffering depression, is what is my value? What is my purpose here? What good am I? And those are very spiritual questions, not necessarily talking about a God, but what is your relationship to this world? What is your place in it? What's your part?
So we want to look next at some simple concepts that you can use as practitioners to start your use of guided imagery, like she was describing earlier, for the clients that get a little anxious about a treatment or something. Probably for us, one of the things that is the best foundation for this type of work is your intent, the mental preparation, making sure that what it is you're trying to establish is clearly held within you and also communicated to the client. Mm-hmm. And you were talking about how you do that, and it's simply saying, gosh, you know, I see that you're nervous, so recognizing and acknowledging that there's an issue, and then saying, would you like to feel more relaxed? Would you like to do something to take your mind off of that? Simply holding that intent is a wonderful way of beginning and helping to make sure that the process goes smoothly.
Now, the setting is important, but only moderately so. We do a lot of work in hospital rooms, things like that, and you know, the setting is just not ideal. But if you did have an ideal setting, you'd have a quiet room where you could play lovely music, perhaps candles or the lights dimmed. That would be ideal, but it's not necessary. Any setting, just having the person close their eyes, their own minds can take them to that place wherever they need to be to relax.
But you can also use the cues within your setting. So if you know that there are sounds of, say, a drill from the next room or even the one that you're using, you can use that to say, as your mind hears that sound, it will simply make you more and more relaxed. So you're using the cues from the environment to help augment and give them suggestions as to what kind of experience you want them to have.
Now, pacing is an interesting part of this. When you're working with a client or a patient, what you initially want to do is you want to pace their behavior. If they come in really, 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 really anxious, you don't want to go so slow. There won't be any connection, there won't be any rapport, and that actually ties into the next slide. You need to pace them. So you can start off kind of active and talkative, and then slow it down. You intentionally slow it down, and they will, without even recognizing, start to slow down as well. I'll let you talk about the breathing if you want.
One of the things that I found, especially working with people in a crisis situation, is if you first meet them where they are, and that's one of the tenets that social workers practice, is meeting the client where they're at. So if they're stressed and anxious, you don't try to be so calm and relaxed initially, because like Catherine indicated, there's not going to be much of an emotional connection. So it's appropriate to hold some of that tension physically to mirror back to them that, okay, I recognize this is a tense. So I'll have clients that are real resistant, and they'll start off the interview like this, and I'll sit back and I won't hold it as tensely, but I'll just kind of mirror back to them what they're looking like. And after a little while, I'll begin putting my arms down, and then I'll bring them back up, and then I'll put them down again. And guess what they begin to do? Eventually they begin to relax, and I can actually lead them to relaxing more, and pretty soon their arms will go down too, simply by following the lead. One of the other techniques that I use a lot of is the pacing with breathing. If you watch their breath, especially once you have them close their eyes, wait until they're exhaling to begin talking to them. On the inhale, pause. And then talk when they're exhaling and give them the suggestions of relaxing. And then when they're beginning to exhale again, and what you're doing is very slowly, you're going to lengthen the amount of time that you're talking, which is going to encourage them to exhale. And all this is nonverbal. You're not telling them what you're doing. You're not telling them to relax. You're simply pacing for them and a behavior you want them to assume. And it's amazing how well this can work. Matter of fact, there was a graduate school that it was a psychology class, and they decided to try an experiment on the instructor. And when the instructor, because he liked to pace and walk around the room when he was lecturing, so what the class agreed to do is when he was over in this corner, they would give him their undivided, wholehearted attention. And the further away from that corner he got, the further from the corner that they got, the less they paid attention to him. So by the end of the semester, guess where he stood for the whole lecture? Over in that corner. Simply by their nonverbal cues as to what is appropriate behavior.
Oh, you know, this works so well in relationships too. Come talk to me afterwards.
So there's a lot that can be done when you're looking at developing the rapport with the client, meeting them where they're at, providing a mirror or a complimentary stance to reflect back to them that initial connectivity.
Okay. Now, how do you get someone to participate with you? If this is something you want to do on a particularly anxious patient that comes in, how would you get them to participate? Would you say, come on, let me do some guided imagery on you? or hypnotize you, what do you think they're going to do? Well, a few might go, oh, wow, that's so cool. But most would go, where are you coming from? Who are you? Ah!
Or most of the clients, especially when I was in hospice, are elderly. Mm-hmm. These are people in their 70s or 80s. I don't simply go up to them and say, hi, I do hypnosis. You want to try some? The chances of being successful with that are very minimal, simply because there's usually some associations that people have with the language that we use to describe these types of activities.
So you want to frame the need. Basically, if someone comes in and they're very anxious, you can just say, I see that you're really tense and this procedure makes you anxious. I've learned something that's kind of interesting. It's just a relaxation tool. Would you like to give it a try? And that's a very soft and gentle way to put it. And you'll find that the patients will be far more receptive. I go, yeah, what is it? Well, it's just using your imagination to go off someplace else. Well, they've all done that. Haven't they ever stared out a window, you know, in a classroom in elementary school when you want to be out in that playground? It's pretty much the same thing.
And like we demonstrated earlier, when you said, no, roller coasters aren't a good thing, mm-hmm. you get that kind of feedback before you get going as part of the introduction of what we're going to be doing. Is there anything that you're afraid of? Are you afraid of confined spaces? What's your favorite place? So part of developing or enhancing the chance of being successful is using the client's information to give you the foundation for what kind of imagery we're going to be working with. Is it a beach scene, or do you have somebody who hates water? Do they hate confined spaces, so you want it someplace out in the open? Or do they have a fear of open spaces, and they're more comfortable being in a more womb-like setting?
So yeah, those would be some of the questions you'd want to ask up front. Are you afraid of water? How do you like grass? How do you like being barefoot? Sometimes that's important. Now, relaxation is a combination of several things. Certainly breathing, if you can encourage yourself or your client to breathe deeply and exhale slowly. Breathing perhaps on the inhale, breathing to a count of five, and then exhaling more slowly to a count of seven or eight will naturally relax the body. Another thing you can do is create an environment that's very soothing. That's not always possible though. Your voice. I have found that your voice can be the most powerful tool in creating a relaxing setting. You know, think of a frightened child. If you can imagine a frightened child running up to you and they're just beside themselves, what do you do? Do you get all, well, I hope you don't get all, Perhaps you get on your knee. Perhaps you hug them. But one of the things you might automatically do is lower your voice. Make your voice very calm and smooth like a warm blanket. Your voice is possibly the most powerful tool you have for relaxing yourself and others. So, and phrasing? Well, that goes back to the receptivity. So, trance states.
One of the things that's interesting is as soon as, well, let's talk about what a trance state is first. One of the things that people often get afraid of when we talk about hypnosis or guided imagery is they're afraid of giving up their control to somebody else. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I have numerous people that will come up and say, oh, I can't be hypnotized, I'm too much of a control freak. Say, well, you're the best candidate because of that control. Because what we're doing is allowing you to take control of your own experience, and you're doing it on yourself. All I am is the facilitator of that process.
So a trance state is simply an altered state of consciousness. Now that does not mean you're in la-la land. It's actually a very natural process that your brain goes in and out of every day, frequently during the day. When you're actively learning, your mind is in a very natural trance state. How about when you're hanging out in front of the TV set, just kind of spacing out?
That's an altered state of consciousness. It's simply a very narrow focus of your attention on a very specific topic. So whether it be TV, or whether it's driving from here up to Austin, and you just kind of disappear in your own thoughts, and all of a sudden you look up and you say, wow, I'm there.
Runner's high, in the zone. You've heard all of these phrases. Those are all natural trance states that we just automatically go into to do whatever's necessary.
So if we went back and looked at our definition of guided imagery, you see that it's the intentional use of imagery to create an experience. So that's all we're doing with guided imagery or hypnosis, is providing you a medium to focus the mind's attention very specifically and narrowly to get that altered state of consciousness. Now, you may have some people who, when they enter a trance state, may be very light. And we've got some of the control freaks who like to open their eyes and check out the room, make sure, yep, everything's fine, you can close your eyes now. So that's one of those ways of looking at that. Don't assume that because they're opening their eyes and checking things out, that they're still not in trance. It happens with us all the time.
So, I just completely lost my spot.
Yes, I noticed. That was fun. Woo! And it's watching some of the clients who, when they were doing the work with them, they'll open their eyes and they'll look around the room and they'll look directly at you, but you also recognize that they're not quite focused either. So those are the people that do a very light trance. Most people go into a medium trance and their eyes remain closed and you can see what's called a facial mask, where the muscles in the face become very relaxed and it almost looks as if they're asleep, but they're not. It's very different than being asleep.
Okay, I think it's important that we offer you a distinction between guided imagery and hypnosis, because we have brought up hypnosis quite a few times in the talk. Guided imagery and hypnosis are virtually the same thing. And it's not something we can do to you. All hypnosis, all guided imagery is self-hypnosis. That is the reality of it. Guided imagery, all you're really doing is you might be taking someone on a very lovely walk with the intention of just relaxing, calming. Hypnosis is a little more specific. We're using verbal cues, and we do what we call trance negotiation sometimes, so we're working very directly with the way they think and subconscious beliefs, and negotiating with those beliefs. So you use guided imagery in hypnosis very actively. They're very, very similar. The only difference is hypnosis is a little bit broader category, using verbal suggestions and negotiation.
Going back to the trance states, looking at the shock concept, any time that someone has had a significant traumatic event, and like maybe a car accident, and they've gotten out of the car and they're kind of sitting on the side of the road, they're in a state of shock. That's also a very heightened state of awareness, and that's when you do have that altered state of consciousness going on. So they're very susceptible to input from a professional at that point. So you can come up and try to help them and say, I see what has happened has been upsetting for you. You're going to be fine and you're going to calm down in just a little while and things are going to be great. And so suddenly that is a suggestion that's been given to them in a very receptive state and will increase the likelihood of having a positive experience out of that situation.
So what we suggest is that you use the trance that they're already in. And you can pretty much guess that if they're in a great deal of pain, if they've had a shock like a sudden death in the family, and they're just not coping, they're already in a trance state, and you can use that. Start where they are and use very loving, nurturing, supporting words to move that emotion.
Other things that you can do in developing your own pattern, your way of using imagery with the clients, is look at some books on color and the meaning that color has to people. And also be aware that there may be cultural differences between color as well. For us in the United States, the color red is associated with what feelings? Intense, anger, a lot of times.
Energy, drive.
It's a very hot emotion. But you go to Japan and the color red is commonly used for weddings. And it's a symbol of renewal and joy. So you have to be aware of some of the cultural values that colors have. So there are some wonderful books that talk about metaphysical uses of colors, symbols, and metaphors.
Now, if you look at your handouts, we gave you several pages. These are very generic and very applicable here in the States of the different colors and their meanings. Different symbolism, like what a house might mean if you are just walking along a path and suddenly you come upon a house in your own mind, what that might mean to you, what a fence might mean. So imagery or symbols are very, very important. They're also very individual, but of course, because we all have some common symbols here culturally, like a white dove, here in the States. We usually associate it with Christianity or with peace.
Unless you're from Alabama, then it's hunting.
But if you go someplace else, they might wonder, well, why are you using a white dove? Oh, white doves are also something we use in working with cancer. People can often see that animal picking its seeds. Imagine throwing seeds on the ground and the seeds be reflective of the cancer cells, and then seeing a swarm of white doves come down, eating up all the seeds.
When we look at emotional content, you also have to be aware of any phobias that the client might have, any dreams that they may have of, and it can be a dream that they have asleep, or a dream as something that they want for their future. And these can be incorporated. If you've got someone who has a strong religious background, then use images and symbols from that context that will help enhance their experience.
And, you know, it's good to know if they're afraid of water. You don't want to take them down a path and have them, you know, strip down and jump into a pond if they're afraid of water. You know, it's kind of common sense, nor do you want to take them up in a balloon, a hot air balloon, if they're afraid of heights. So it's okay to just ask, hey, is there anything you're afraid of? Anything that you find really uncomfortable? And let them tell you. Likewise, it's all right to say, what do you really love? You know, if you could have anything you wanted right now, or anything you wished you could have done during such and such time span, and let them tell you what their dreams are, and then incorporate that in. And that's how you'd use it therapeutically. Now, for yourself, you have all this internalized. All you have to do is get very quiet with an intent to use imagery to support yourself lovingly.
So how we use imagery as a healing modality. The World Health Organization defined health as a state of physical, emotional, and spiritual well-being. And now what we're excited to see is that more and more of the Western concept of medicine is incorporating this holistic idea that we can't just keep treating a body and expect the person to retain wellness. So what we'd like to do next is give you an opportunity to experience for yourself what a relaxation imagery session would be like. And we're going to take about 8 minutes, and I'll walk you through it. I know we're almost out of time. Sorry.
What I'd like you to do is, as you're sitting in your chair, just go ahead and get comfortable in your chair.
Can we?
Yeah, you go to hit the little panel on the right where it's dark, but it should be dark.
Lighting?
Oh, okay.
Lighting and go to 5.
Okay, no drooling, though, okay?
Now, if any of you start snoring, I'll come over and tap you on the shoulder, okay? But I invite you now to just go ahead and allow yourself to relax as much as comfortable in that chair. Why don't you start off by taking a couple deep breaths, filling the lungs up as much as comfortable, and letting that air go slowly and completely. Do that a couple times, 2 or 3 times, breathing deeply. And letting that air go slowly and completely. Now I invite you to bring your attention up to the very top of your head and imagine a quiet, soothing sensation starting to form. You might imagine this like a soft hat, or perhaps a gentle cloud of color starting to form. And just allow that quietness to slide down gently and easily, flowing down over the forehead, down through the cheeks, Imagine that quietness settling now down in your jaw. And take just a moment to bring your attention into your jaw, your mouth. That's where so many of us hold on to our attention. Loosen those muscles, relax them. And when you're ready, take a deep breath. And as you let it go, allow that quiet relaxation to slide down your neck, flowing down gently, easily into your shoulders, loosening, relaxing, easing tension. Perhaps you can imagine the muscles in your back loosening and relaxing, almost like untying shoelaces in an old favorite pair of tennis shoes. Loosening those muscles all the way down. And allowing that quiet restfulness to settle all the way down your back, down into your hips. Now bring your attention down, down into your legs. And for just this time, they're not having to work or support anything. And they too can relax comfortably and completely. Just allowing that chair to support your body comfortably, effortlessly. Now as you're resting there in that chair here, I invite you to take a walk with me. Perhaps you can imagine yourself somewhere outside. It's a beautiful day, just perfect. Walking along a gentle path, and you can feel a soft breeze against your skin, perhaps. I wonder if you can even imagine the birds singing. And take time to notice all the beautiful colors around you. Bright, vivid greens. White clouds. The blue of the blue sky. Just notice all the things you might see and hear, what you might feel as you walk along calmly and comfortably in that environment. Now just ahead of you, over to your right, I'd like you to imagine a large, beautiful oak tree, if you will. And just under that tree, there's a box there waiting. And this box is for you. You just know it belongs to you. And I invite you to go over there and pick that box up. And allow yourself to open it. Whatever's inside is something very valuable to you, important at this time. And I invite you to bring that box back with you. As you comfortably, easily, and effortlessly carry it back down the path, returning comfortably to the awareness of your body sitting in that chair here in this room. Bring your awareness back to your breathing comfortably. Now come on back. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, eyes open, 10. Come on back. Okay, take just a moment. And what was that like for you? Anyone relaxed?
Any idea how long that was?
Oh, yeah.
You actually only were there for about 5 minutes. And it's amazing what we can do just in 5 minutes to lower the stress level of someone or help to achieve a more relaxed state of being.
Now, was anybody able to see a box or retrieve a box? Okay, we just threw that in there for fun. Did anybody get anything inside their box? Would anybody be willing to share?
A pillow and a blanket.
A pillow and a blanket. What do you think that means to you?
That I was up till 3.
So what does she need most right now?
Rest.
Yes. So it's interesting, if you do an imagery on yourself, and you can do this in your own home, just for yourself, take yourself on a walk. If you're not quite sure what it is you need right now, and you do this imagery of going and finding a box or finding something with the instruction of this is something you need, something that's important to you right now. Yes?
I had something to read. I took someone along with me on the path.
Oh, well, that's fine.
Which you hadn't. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. All of a sudden found myself that I wasn't on the path all of a sudden.
This is what you'll find in guided imagery and hypnosis is the person will do what they need to do. You can have them in a beautiful park, and they could be in Antarctica. If that's where they need to be, that's where they will be. And you'll hear clients occasionally go, well, you know, I was trying so hard to go back to that park, but, you know, I finally gave it up and just stayed in Antarctica. Oh, well, that's fine. Your mind will very naturally take you where you need to go to do whatever healing is necessary. Did anybody end up with an empty box? This is always very interesting. Excuse me?
It was empty at first, and I thought maybe that's because I'm moving and I need empty boxes.
Certainly. Whatever you find in your box, you have to remember it's symbolic, first of all. Now, I've had people that go, oh, you know, I found an empty box. That means I'm not doing it right. And then you just question just a little to say, what is it you really need in your life? Man, I'm so stressed. I don't need anything more in my life. I wish I could just get away. What does that say? Yes?
Found a cloud in mind.
Oh, how lovely. What does that say to you?
I don't know.
Well, when you think of a cloud, okay, I'm in Aruba sitting back in a chair looking up at the clouds. So. Yeah.
Okay.
So, whatever you've got in the box would be symbolic of something that you need or something that's important to you.
So hopefully we've given you some basic ideas of what guided imagery can do, some of the historical context, some of the basic ideas of what you can do to enhance this as a tool for you to give yourself something else and another way to help the clients and people that we work with. I'm Russell Gaynor, this is Catherine. We've got our stuff down in the front. If you need to get a hold of us, we've got brochures and cards. And we thank you very much for the opportunity to come and present this morning.
Now, we do still have time for questions.
Do
we still have time for questions?
No,
I think we have time. Our next speaker is not in the room yet, so go ahead.
Okay, fire away. Any questions?
Do you use this to help people who maybe not are going through a tunnel or
yes.
More of a maybe been through emotional or a violent or?
What I have found using hypnosis, I work with several counselors in town, and it's very common for clients to have gone through an emotional trauma or whatever issue, and they reach a a point in their process of healing, and they understand what all their issues are, the origins, et cetera, but they can't take that next step of letting it go or redefining themselves. You also see this in grief management when you're working with someone who's just lost a partner. They can't possibly imagine what their life is going to look like alone. So guided imagery is a very useful and a very gentle tool to help them redefine who they are.
And you actually used it for people who are trying to conceive.
Yes, yeah, fertility issues, certainly, because fertility issues are directly related to, other than the biological, it's directly related to stress. And the stress affects the biological affects the stress, and it's just a compounding situation. And so guided imagery and hypnosis are used very effectively in that area. Any other questions?
All right. Well, thanks, guys. We've
thanks
had a lot
so
of fun this morning. Our pleasure.
Appreciate it.
Thanks.
You larger.